Our third and final panel for today will be a panel discussion on key shared island projects that can help to connect the island. And we have four extremely well-informed speakers, Paul Bartholomew from Ulster University, Philip Nolan from Science Foundation Ireland, Tania Banotti from Creative Ireland, and Pamula Arthurs from the East Border region. And they'll now join us on stage. Thank you and welcome. Philip Nolan is the Director General of Science Foundation Ireland, a role he's held since January of 22. For many people in the South, he was one of the faces of COVID and probably a memory that he's glad to leave behind, as so many of us are. Hugely involved in research and the way in which we're trying to develop third level research, and he will be in charge of the new research agency which is being formed by the amalgamation of Science Foundation Ireland and the IRC. Tania Banotti is the director of the Creative Ireland programme, which bids to put creativity at the centre of public policy. And it is a huge area for growth, and it's also obviously a huge area for development in terms of connections. And before becoming a public servant, she's had a long and varied career and a successful one involved with a great number of creative organizations, including Screen Producers Ireland, Theatre Forum, the National Campaign for the Arts, and the list goes on. And finally, our last speaker is Paul Bartholomew of Ulster University. He's the Vice-Chancellor of Ulster, one of the most complex universities of its type anywhere, given the number of campuses that it has. It's clearly a challenging role. And before entering the world of higher education, he was a clinician in the National Health Service as a diagnostic radiographer, so he knows life from all sides of the world. And finally, Pamula Arthurs from the East Border region, which has been around for 50 years, has survived good days and bad, and has managed to put a lot of money and administered a lot of money over the years in the tens of millions on cross-border funds. And there's few people who are probably better experienced at the micro level management of how cross-border work has to go on. So could I start with all of you, and perhaps literally starting with you, Pamula, and we'll come in from there. In terms of what Shared Island can do for all of you, the point was made in the last panel that a lot of this work, or some of this work, is being done already, but that Shared Island creates a tent, as it were, to provide a focus and to drive forward conversations and perhaps set deadlines.
Yeah, well, I suppose to put it into context, in terms of East Border Region, the local, at the local authority level, we have been working on a cross-border basis for many years, as you say, up to 50 years, and indeed wider than our own organisation, other Northern Ireland local authorities have been working primarily with the border counties. And the catalyst for that in the past has been, and continuing thankfully, has been the EU-funded Interreg programme and also the distinct peace programmes that we've availed of. And as you say, over the years that money has helped us to transform particularly the Ireland-Northern Ireland border corridor. It's important to say as well from the local authority perspective that in our own organisation, politicians from all the political parties sit round the table together and make the decisions about cross-border cooperation. When things have, haven't been happening at a national level, that has still continued. So at that local and regional level, in that 50 years, we've always had that commitment from the local level. But again, the local elected members are working for their own communities and they see the impact of the funding. Shared Island has been very welcome. It's brought a new dimension to that, in that we have typically worked Northern Ireland and the border counties, but Shared Island has allowed us to look on a much wider basis. So for example, in our own area, Armagh, Banbridge, Craigavon Council availed of the local authority Shared Island funding with Galway County Council. And that was around the whole city of culture, Galway having been the city of culture, Armagh, Banbridge, Craigavon were vying then for city of culture. They didn't actually get it, but still the experience was shared. As well as that, in Carlingford Lough, which is nicely just behind me here, we've had significant Interreg investment, EU investment there, just finishing as we speak the Carlingford Lough Greenway, which again you can see linking Portadown, Newry, O'Meath, Carlingford, and finally Greenower. The Taoiseach has talked this morning about the monies, and it's very welcome for the Narrow Water Bridge, which will be the physical link there that you can see behind me. We also have the Carlingford Ferry, which links Greenore and Greencastle. So that whole area has opened up, and the bridge, you know, hopefully when it is done, will be very significant. So Sherd Island has been a catalyst. You know, the local authority development funding has enabled us to look on a wider basis and is encouraging councils in Ireland who typically haven't looked towards Northern Ireland, encouraging them to do that. And then in our own organisation, to conclude, we're also looking now at the Climate Fund, Sherd Island opportunities. I've been speaking to Tania this morning about her creative opportunities through Sherd Island, and hopefully we in East Border are primarily enablers, facilitators, and that's what we hope we will continue to do. I'm sorry, one last point. We also have the significant Peace Plus 1.1 billion fund which has just literally opened. But again, Sherd Island is playing its part in that catalyst and enabling projects to develop, you know, feasibility studies, develop concepts into possible projects which can be funded either from Peace Plus or from Sherd Island itself.
Phillips, same question to you in terms of what Sherd Island, that tent, can achieve for you or help to achieve for you.
Just kind of in principle, first of all, it's probably worth addressing the question. So I lead a research funding agency. And what does that deliver for a community or for society? And we believe that investing in research and investing in people doing research creates a talent base, a knowledge base, and access to a global knowledge base that will drive innovation. And I don't just mean technological innovation, I mean social innovation and cultural innovation, and lead to a prosperous, inclusive, vibrant society and economy and culture as a consequence. In the context of Sherd Island, then, investing in research, I want to start actually with a program that wasn't a Sherd Island program, which is I'm going to give three examples of where research and innovation initiatives are yielding really tangible results for the island as a whole. The first example is the US Ireland RD&I partnership, which arose out of the Belfast Good Friday Agreement and the commitments made then. It's a US Ireland Northern Ireland initiative. It's always tripartite collaborations across the three. It took a time to get off the ground. It started in 2006, and since 2006, about over €150 million it has been invested in 80 projects through that program. In areas like nanoscience, health, agriculture, priority areas identified by the three governments at the time. And I mentioned that because it did two things. It created proof of principle that there was value in bringing people together to do research, because when you bring people together to co-create solutions for a community or an island as a whole, you get a tangibly different result than if any given jurisdiction does that research in isolation. So it gave proof of principle and laid the groundwork then for two really important Sherd Island initiatives. The first being the Higher Education Authority North-South program run by our sister agency, the Higher Education Authority. That's €50 million in 62 projects in the first call. Everything, it's very broad in its scope, from an all-island cancer research program out to the potential role of transformative mediation in peace building. So the full spectrum of kind of research that would be relevant to us as a society and community. And then earlier today, the Taoiseach did allude to the announcement just before Christmas by Minister Harris from our government, Secretary of State Michelle Donlan from the UK government, and from the Northern Ireland Department of Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs of the creation of two co-centres. It's important to recognise immediately, I kind of laboured the announcement, these are North, South and East, West initiatives sponsored by our government, the Northern Ireland government and the UK government. There we're talking about €70 million investment in, on the one hand, two centres, one in climate, biodiversity and water. I mean, pause, there could be no more important topic for us to deal with as an all-island venture, and the other in sustainable and resilient food systems. And of that 70 million, €40 million coming from the Irish government, half from our core budget and half from the Shared Island Fund, £17 million from the Northern Ireland Department that I mentioned, and £12 million through UK Research and Innovation. So I think the simple thing to say is there is real momentum in the mind of the three governments. I think it was Edwin Poots, actually, when he was minister, that sponsored the Northern Ireland investment in this before Stormont collapsed. There's a real momentum at this juncture behind coming together as an island and pursuing research and innovation as a collaborative entity, not just for the results we generate, but for the fact that it brings people together in a new and really stimulating way.
Okay. Tania, in terms of your organisation and the things you do and how Shared Island is helping you.
Yeah, so the Creative Ireland programme is what's known in the jargon as an all-of-government programme, and it's got two big, hairy, audacious goals. And the first of those was the idea of the role of culture and creativity across government policy in every single government department. And the second is the statement that the well-being of the people of Ireland is our greatest asset, and a conviction that participating in cultural and creative activities contributes to our well-being. So when I was thinking about how Shared Island got started, I think if it wasn't for Micheál Martin and the current Taoiseach and the political system saying, we want this, we're just gonna do it, the system might have taken a bit longer. And we were about 5 years earlier where politicians said at the end of the decade of centenaries, what is the legacy of Ireland looking back? And the then Taoiseach Enda Kenny said, the legacy is the Creative Ireland programme. So we got contacted by the Taoiseach because it's that kind of sense of the political system wanting things to happen. A large part of what we're doing in Creative Ireland is around opportunities for everybody on the island of Ireland to be creative, but we were previously doing that just in the Republic. And what was exciting for us is that the Taoiseach said very clearly, I do not want this to be one-off. I'm going to give €6 million to the Creative Ireland programme, and I want you to meaningfully bring people together, not on a once-off, through different kind of creative activities so that we can build that consensus. A bit like what we heard the young people on the panel say earlier, that the Taoiseach's unit brought them together for a whole weekend where they broke bread and ate together and, you know, did all the interesting things that made that connection so meaningful. So that is the huge challenge for Creative Ireland. It's how do we do people-to-people projects involving civil society north and south. And so we've kind of divided it up. There's a whole area of our work which is around opportunities for children and young people to do creative projects together. And that will literally mean busing people up and down and bringing them together regularly. And we've just announced that grant call. And what was very interesting for us, Mark, is that there's a lot of interest in artists, creative organisations, community groups doing things north-south. But what's often missing is, who do I call when I want to call Northern Ireland? Like, I'm a break project and I don't know who to partner with. So sometimes what we're finding is that there isn't the connectedness that we would like, but there's a great interest and keenness to do things. So we have a whole programme around children and young people. And secondly, we have a programme involving many people who are here in the hall today. So Creative Ireland has an officer in every local authority. Thank you all for coming. And they are leading out on projects. And a bit like you were saying, a lot of interest in local authorities on the border county. They're well used to it. They're well used to peace money. A different challenge if we're looking at Cork County Council doing something north of the border, maybe not as many links as we would have liked, but we're putting that at...
Is that fear or lack of knowledge?
Just lack of contacts. Or, yeah. Just lack of contacts. I think there's a great interest and willingness, as Philip said, like we want to do this, and you know, it's really clear from the Taoiseach that this is only going in one direction in terms of funding and political interest. Yeah. But I think, you know, local authorities have a lot on their plate. They're being asked to do a great deal around climate action, building communities, all of that. And so they may not necessarily have connections in the north.
And you can help them that.
Yeah.
Okay, same question to you, Paul, in terms of the work you're doing of a cross-border nature and how Shared Ireland can help at least with part of that action.
I think the Shared Ireland as a kind of a movement and a funding mechanism has helped catalyse a number of things. Clearly, as a university on the island of Ireland, we were collaborating pretty heavily with other universities and institutions on the island and other entities too. But when Shared Ireland came along as a proposition, you won't be surprised to know there's a pot of money there, and people are saying, what are you going to do to try to get your hands on some of it, and what are the propositions you're going to put forward? Mm. There's a lot of emphasis and I think a pressure for us, especially in the Northwest, given the proximity of our campus in Derry, in terms of what we were going to do there, and it was seen as a real opportunity. So yes, we had some funds to go after, but actually what that meant is that how do you do that? You do that through conversations, and the conversations about, you know, what's important, what's achievable, what might we be able to put in place, meant that I think we have built, I've certainly personally have built new relationships with the government and the civil servants here in the South to understand what we can do together. And I think they're challenged back about, you know, what can you do for us and for the whole island. Now, I was very taken by the Taoiseach earlier when he said, you know, it's kind of low-key and non-constitutional, and that's really been an important part of it. It means that it's been depoliticised, really, and it's really synergised with what we do as a university. As universities, has that great synergy with politics. It's all about people. Universities are all about people. It's central to our strategy, which is called People, Place and Partnership. We put people first. Politics is all about that. And, of course, the university doesn't really respect the notions of the border. We have students coming across the border all the time. I think we have about 2,500 Republic of Ireland students at Ulster, about 1,800, a bit more than 1,800 actually, would be on campus. And we have large numbers of staff who go across the border. So we've always been kind of a cross-border institution in terms of where we are. So it was an opportunity to take that context and think, what will we do next? And certainly members of the community, other stakeholders, when they saw the Shared Ireland, wanted to know what we were going to do in response to that opportunity. It took us about 2 years actually to get there in writing an iteration of bids before we got to the right one.
Well, all of these things take time. But in terms of the future, and you talked about the deep political nature of it, and people have been very careful to stay away from the constitutional issues. This is about people coming together, and that clearly has been of value. Where do all of you see the possibilities for cooperation in the years ahead, set against whatever political backdrop we all have to live with and none of us can predict? I mean, Pamela, you're running an organisation, your committee, I think every member of it is a politician, is that correct? So they're all having to respond to their own internal pressures. How optimistic are you for the future in terms of where the level of practical cooperation along the border, and not just with border councils, could be in 5 or 10 years' time?
I would be very optimistic. I mean, obviously, when Brexit happened, that was an issue for us, a genuinely cross-border organisation, that all of a sudden one part of, half of the organisation was no longer in the European Union. The European Union had been our main funder, and again, when you talk about practical cross-border cooperation, that's what we're about, for mutual benefit, simply because that's what will keep the politicians around the table that they're saying that there is mutual benefit and it's benefiting their own areas. Sitting here today, we have a $1 billion shared island fund, which is there for practical cross-border cooperation. We have a $1.1 billion Peace Plus programme. So for the foreseeable, the rest of this decade, we know that we will continue to source the monies and to draw that down. After that, I think again, we've always worked very practically. I think the governments will still be committed to continuing cross-border cooperation because there's never a quick fix. Cross-border cooperation is never easy and you can never say that's it done. You change continually, you adapt, you have to be flexible. You walk a tightrope on many occasions, but I would actually be currently very optimistic, more optimistic than I have been at certain periods over the past few years. So I think the future looks good. The main thing is that we are that the cross-border cooperation makes sense, that it meets a need. As has been said all morning, when people sit down and actually talk to each other, there are more common issues than there are differences. And when people see that you can actually address your own issues, but in a wider cross-border project, that resonates. Yeah. And that's where people will buy into that. And we've continued at our level, looked at the economic benefit, that doesn't frighten anyone.
Anybody.
Yeah. That everybody can work together and see that output.
And Philip, the same question to you, the depolitical nature of it and the importance of that in terms of keeping everybody on board, getting momentum, practical results, everybody can unite around an outcome.
Yeah, I think, again, I'm very optimistic. I'm optimistic for two reasons. I think the political sponsorship remains very strong, and the political system is increasingly seeing the value of research in terms of building a better society, addressing environmental issues, building a sustainable economy and a fair economy. So, and I do want to point out that the forthcoming amalgamation that you refer to, Science Foundation Ireland, which I currently lead, which is a science funding agency, and the Irish Research Council, which funds everything but is the sole funder of arts, humanities and social sciences. Mm-hmm. I think when we bring that together in one agency, and it's interesting, our legislation was amended in 2013 to permit us to fund into Northern Ireland, and the new agency's legislation also allows it to fund into Northern Ireland, where it's part of a partnership. If you take that agency and it has an orientation towards all-island collaboration, when you're bringing in everything from music and poetry to sociology and political science alongside the natural sciences and beginning to have them talk, the capacity of that to sponsor further dialogue, further innovation, further deliberation, to even imagine, never mind create the kind of society we want into the future and express it, is really, really very powerful. And just one very final quick comment. A real ambition of mine is to start to sponsor the possibility of doctoral students, PhD students on either side of the border coming together much more often than they might currently do, right, to begin to work together rather than in isolation. Because I think the whole day today has spoken to the power of having dialogue between people working on issues. Okay. And we'd really like to see that into the future.
Thank you, Philip. Tania, in one of the previous debates, the young people who were with us for Shared Ireland, the Youth Forum, were talking about how when they gather, they talk about mental health, they talk about housing, transport. None of them are talking about the constitutional issues. Presumably the same.
Yeah, the same is true. Is true with our groups. I mean, I think that one of the young people talked about a shared space. And I think that to the earlier point, we have to acknowledge that there aren't as many shared spaces as we would like. So if civic society is to get together, we have to, it's almost like ploughing the ground before the trees can grow. We've got to kind of get fertilizer in and get opportunities to get together. And that That is one challenge. And I think the other challenge that we just do have to name that stone, certainly our experience going to the north, and certainly the creative community is very underfunded in Northern Ireland. There's a funding crisis. So we have to be sensitive that we're going sometimes saying, oh, we have funds through Shared Ireland, and people are saying to us, we literally can't keep the lights on here, so that's lovely, but we're being challenged because of difficulty. So I think there is a sensitivity that we have to bear in mind when we're doing these people-to-people projects, that, you know, you can only do that when somebody actually can put bread on the table first. Yeah. But the shared space is absolutely vital. To your point, this is a long game. And if the Martin Luther King, I have a dream, is going to happen, the dream is that all of these connections are going to be much richer and deeper, and it won't necessarily rely on lots of public funding. But for that to happen, we've got to commit long term now to building those networks.
Okay. Paul, I was struck by the previous debate where they were talking about how difficult, how the lack of information that second-level students, both sides of the border, have about the college opportunities that are available on either side. And yet you have 1,800 students, so clearly people are getting information from some quarters. Is there more that could be done on that?
Certainly. In fact, when I listened to that, I sat there and thought myself, we have to do more on this for that very reason. I do think schools themselves and the way that they, careers, teachers and so forth, push what they know and the relationships, and there's certainly a role for universities and other tertiary education institutions to think a bit more fully on a full island basis. It's difficult, I suppose, a little bit. In Northern Ireland, we have a capped system, so actually, and we're full, which means if you're doing additional marketing to bring additional students in, then that means you'll take less students from elsewhere.
Right.
So I think there's a big conversation to be had in Northern Ireland about freeing up the system so that the people who wish to go can go. I know that that's a conversation that's on politicians' minds too, and I'm open to entertaining
and a
that.
A difficult one. Okay, we'll go to the floor. We have a lady here in the second row, I think, if we can get a microphone. Just here. And maybe we could identify a second speaker or a second questioner as well.
Hello, my name is Gilly Fogg. I'm the head creative at Lighthouse Studios in Kilkenny, which is animation. But my hometown is Clonus, County Monaghan. And this is a question for Tania. And also, Pamela, I loved everything that you've said about cross-border cooperation, which is what I grew up with and really familiar with. And I love the audacious ambition that everyone on this island should have a rich creative life, and I think that's fabulous. And thinking about a broader thought on sharing this island, Clonus, and which used to have a thriving railway, to someone else's point, has now so many people who, like Georgia from the youth people, youth panel, have no idea of the history of the border. Like, a lot of people in Clonus are from Nepal, Syria, Ukraine, and how can we help them to have a fulfilling creative life? Are there ways of bringing them into this program?
Okay, Tania, will you?
Yeah, well, is Deirdre McQuaid in the room, the Creative Ireland coordinator in Monaghan County Council? She's there waving her hand. There's some incredible examples in Cavan Monaghan of really brilliant local creative projects with new communities, existing communities, and border communities. And I think the answer here is devolve down, that the good people who are living in Cavan Monaghan are well capable of saying for themselves what kind of creative projects they would like to do. And I think that's been the secret sauce of the way we work, which is, you know, Deirdre will be asking communities in Clonus. There was the phenomenal event in Hilton Park with 100 young people from north and south and from Glasgow who rehearsed for, is it 8 months, Deirdre, to come together in this incredible music performance. And there were new communities and communities from all sides of the island. And that was a project that literally grew out of Cavan Monaghan. So I think our answer, certainly in Creative Ireland, is not that this is somehow coming from a government department in Dublin. It's like, what do the good people of Clonus want to do, and let's support them to do it.
Pamela, would you add?
Yes, I agree entirely. I think in any of these projects, it's important that they are bottom-up and that there's needs-based. And it's also important, I suppose, again, to say that the funding that is out there specifically for cross-border cooperation, that is a carrot. You know, we're not at a stage where this will still happen without the funding. So, I mean, it's an opportunity, certainly, and if someone comes forward with the idea, I've no doubt that, you know, there will be possible avenues, but again, about Tania on the creative aspect.
But I think, to your point, Mark, like, it doesn't always have to be about the constitutional question. You know, we've done an amazing project with circus and street art with kids from the Divis Flats going to Cork. We've done Rhyme Island, we've done rap projects. Nothing to do with the constitutional question. Like, we can use creative approaches that bring people together, and we're not all discussing the constitutional question.
Yeah, we were talking in some of the pre-interview stuff that we did in recent days, and I was making the point that there's a huge amount of work clearly going on with all of you, but yet if you were to go out on the street and actually explain this to people, I think quite a lot of people would be surprised by the depth of the work that's being done in many ways, because and the image I gave to you was the reality that I would see is an awful lot of the traffic on the M1 coming southwards that I mentioned to you is going to the airport or IKEA, and the traffic going northwards is going to the Titanic Quarter. And yes, we have the 5-10 mile crossover in Cavan-Monaghan and all along the border counties. But you know, if you go to Belfast on a midweek and you look for Southerton Reg cars, they're not everywhere. You know, you do have to look quite a bit.
Yeah,
I know this provoked ire from you at the time, but the point still has some degree of validity that we're two parts of an island where people don't know each other anywhere near well enough.
Well, I'm sure we can all sort of feed into that, but I feel very strongly that that is the case. Now, of course, I've just come from Monaghan County Council and seen loads of reg cars from the north who are clearly working in Monaghan County Council, but that's a unique situation. It is absolutely true, Mark, we do not have those links. So it's not going to somehow overnight we're going to get civil society doing loads of these people-to-people projects. It's our job now to kind of go, gosh, are you aware of so-and-so doing something up there? You might be very interested. We have to have some people on the ground that are kind of making those connections. And once those are made, things can fly. But we can't assume that, you know, who do you know when you want to call Cork if you're in Belfast? That won't necessarily happen.
And the same thing, presumably, Philip and Paul, applies in universities, that it is about the personal contact.
Oh, it's absolutely about the personal contact. It's the very purpose of universities is to transform lives, whether that's through teaching or whether that's through research with impact. That's what we're there to do. And I do think that, you know, there are some reasonably... I was going to say, it'd be wrong to say they're artificial constraints. There are some constraints that don't relate to people's desire to interact with universities. There are economic constraints put on for other fiscal reasons. But we have to acknowledge the fact that we have a constrained system. Mm. And if we're expecting to change and grow and flourish, we need to do something around those infrastructural, financial, fiscal underpinnings to allow that change
and
to take place.
And social ambition that people see college as being part of their life.
Yeah, but I actually think that until we've cured the other issues, we can't do that. Yeah. Because if we were to do a marketing campaign in Ireland for people to come north, we couldn't...
You're faced with the cap.
We're faced with the cap. Yeah. And they could come, but they would displace other students perhaps from Northern Ireland from going. So I think we do need to kind of clear the way. And it's almost a bit like build it and they will come. In this age, you change it and they will come.
Philip?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is all about creating the opportunities to build trusted relationships and build on trusted relationships. It's amazing how many people in the course today, like the Taoiseach saying about the Ministerial Council, it's important that we just meet. And you can translate that out much more broadly. It's important. And there are kind of natural obstacles to mobility between jurisdictions. And they're often small things that, again, were alluded to by the young people earlier. Where those exist, then it's in the interests of us all to put in place mechanisms that overcome those natural barriers, either by kind of removing them where they can be removed or making it easy for people to move and interact. Mm-hmm. And I think that's been one of the great successes of sponsoring All Island Research is we've got people working together who might not naturally have worked together because of those small barriers. And once you go down that road, it gathers a momentum of its own over time.
Okay, fantastic. Questioner here, I think, in the middle of the hall.
Thanks very much. My name is Neil McCann. I've been involved in reconciliation work for some years, mainly in Belfast, and previously involved in local government in the East Coast, County Louth. So I just want to thank you all for a very forward-looking and very positive and realistic conversation. I'd like to thank Tania for mentioning the trees as in a metaphorical terms. What I wanted to mention was the possibility of possibly through Shared Ireland or possibly other institutions of governance, that the forestation programs, which is now well underway in Ireland in the south, but is not in the north, and where we have quite generous supports now for landowners in the south to be growing to be growing trees, and particularly the native and the hardwood trees, that I wanted to mention the possibility of that being done on an all-island basis, where a significant support could be given to the reforestation or the forestation of the north, to the Sperrin Mountains and the Glens and other places where farming is in decline and there are fewer and fewer full-time farmers, and this could certainly help with their being able to generate support from their own land. And the British government could be invited to participate in the funding of that. And I mean, there are now well-established precedents for the Irish government supporting programs in the north. And it could be viewed from the new A5, M5 motorway when people are driving from Omagh to Sion Mills. You just Fantastic. Have to look to the right. Okay. And the second thing is, I'm aware that the Irish government is also supporting Erasmus for Irish students and Northern Irish students in Europe. I'm not sure if that's reciprocated, if there is support for non-Irish students coming on Erasmus programs to Ireland and to the north in particular. So there are just those two points.
Okay. Can I stop you there? I'm not sure that forestation is necessarily the comfort zone of any of the panelists on stage, but anybody who wishes to have...
Just on a positive note, our job as a research funding agency is to support the researchers that might guide the political system towards appropriate interventions in biodiversity, and we are funding an all-island research program in biodiversity. So it wouldn't surprise me at all if an outworking of that is policy advice in terms of how we might treat...
Okay. Paul, the Erasmus point?
On the Erasmus, certainly I think the funding that's come from the Irish government to kind of backfill Erasmus will help with student mobility. The Turing scheme, that's the UK one, only funds outward mobility. But my understanding, and I would have to check this, is because it's Erasmus, there is some capacity for inward and outward in the new funds that have come in.
Okay, we can take one brief question, so please be brief and obviously identify yourself.
Conor O'Malley's my name, Secretary of the Irish Association for Cultural, Economic and Social Relations. Question relates to travel outside the border areas. In order for people to go south or north, for whatever reason, unless you've relatives, a place to stay, you have to pay up or leave. And it's very important, particularly for cultural relations, that the barriers that put up those costs, like the hiring of venues, the payment of VAT, the cost of accommodation, that those extra costs for going there can be mitigated. Okay. Culture Ireland had such a mechanism for the rest of the world, but ironically, the one place where it does not apply is Northern Ireland.
Okay. Tania,
a suggestion. One for you.
Well, we have Maureen Kennelly, the Director of the Arts Council, in the audience, and I'm sure she can later talk about the various ways in which she's trying to support artist exchange north and south. All I can say is that for the funding that we've been given from Shared Ireland, we will literally be covering buses, trains, hotels, like that is a big part of the cost, because if the Taoiseach wishes to be fulfilled, that this has to be meaningful, regular contact, then those expenses absolutely must be paid. So certainly from our point of view, but I think the Arts Council might be better to say what they will cover for artists exchanging north-south.
Okay, on that note, I'm afraid we have to bring proceedings to a close. Forgive me, but I'm under a clock. We have, hopefully you've enjoyed the session, and there will be an opportunity to talk afterwards, so perhaps there can be some follow-up conversation. Hopefully all of you have got some nugget from today that has made your time here worthwhile, and everybody watching at home. I think it's been a fascinating morning, and it does show an awful lot of the work that is being done, perhaps that doesn't necessarily get the attention that it deserves. So if I could ask you to thank Paul Bartholomew from Ulster University, Philip Nolan from Science Foundation Ireland, Tania Banotti from Creative Ireland, and Pamula for the East Border region, and for a fascinating half hour. Thank you.